Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's message. Let's just wait a bit so that people can start coming into the live stream. It's good to be back. Actually, we had a pause during the month of August, but we are back, so stay tuned. Because on the next Sundays, we will have new messages. And feel also free to join us. On Wednesdays, we are back also on the prayer meetings. So you can join us in Zoom. Both of these events, they are at 9 p.m. CET. So you are welcome to join us and to share also with friends and family. Let's just give a bit more time so that people can come in. And also tonight's message, the title is The Often Forgotten Weapon We Can Use. The Often Forgotten Weapon We Can Use. Okay, I think we can start now. Welcome, everyone. We are happy to have you. And we are happy that we are starting again our live streams. So stay tuned, because every Sunday we will have a new message here on Facebook. And also you can watch the previous sessions on Facebook and also on our YouTube channel. So tonight I have the pleasure to introduce you the speaker. So she is a former engineer and now she is a physical therapist. She was born in an Adventist family and she likes do-it-yourself projects. She is like my best, she is also my best friend, and thankfully she is also my wife. So welcome, Raquel.
Hi, everyone.
Okay, so I have two questions for you. The first one is, how did you get to know the Europe for Jesus movement?
So about 4 or 5 years ago, we met Jen, and also Enoch introduced us the project Europe for Jesus, and we went for the first time on the Europe for Jesus mission trip 4 years ago to South Africa.
Okay, and tell us, what was the mission trip that had the most impact in your life and why?
I think it was the last one, the one that was on the last year, because we met an elder, Brother Israel, and he had a problem with his feet, and he was not walking right, but he worked for God even though he had those limitations. So we have two normal feet, we have two hands, we can speak, we can see, we can hurt. And sometimes we don't work for God with what we have. And Brother Israel, he was walking a lot of kilometers to do visitation to the people that were meeting God. And he gave Bible studies to a lot of people, and people gave their lives to Jesus. So that was one of the things that impacted me the most.
Yeah, and also despite the difficulties that he has, also speaking, she ended up being our translator during the message. So before we proceed with tonight's message, we would like to invite you to watch a special music. Thank you.
Spirit, give me feet to follow true. Give me hands to touch the hurting and the faith to follow you. Give me grace to be a servant. Give me mercy for the lost. Give me passion for your glory. Give me passion for the cross. And I will go where there are no easy roads. Live the comfort that I know.
Thank you, Chris, for this beautiful song. And I would like to invite you to bow your heads so that we can start with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, O Lord, we ask you for your presence. We ask you for your guidance. We ask you for wisdom to Raquel. Please give her the right words. And please, Lord, let your Holy Spirit work in our hearts so that we are open for your message for tonight. Guide each word, and may your name be glorified. And may each one of us, each one of the people that is listening to this message, be blessed and be closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Feel free to share this message with your friends and family. And Raquel, the word is yours.
Thank you. Okay. So, welcome everyone again. And the message I bring to you tonight is something that I discovered and rediscovered. Okay, I have a question to start. Do you know that Jesus promised that he would come again to this earth? You know, we can find this promise in John 14. And we read, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." And on verse 18 and 28, Jesus makes again the promise, "I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." And verse 28, "You have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you." So Jesus is coming again to take us to his Father's house, but because he wants us to be with him. But we need to have our life in order and in harmony with him. And now I would ask you to close your eyes and bow your head and pray again with me, so that we can talk to the Lord once more. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings of life. We thank you because you have given us everything we have. Thank you, Lord, because you gave us your word, and because we can find in this word hope and forgiveness. But now, O Lord, I want to ask for your Holy Spirit, that he can work in my mind, in my heart, in my words, and also that he can work in the hearts and minds of those who are listening to us. May they see Jesus. May they see what you want us to change in our lives. And I ask that your power be with us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so we need to have our life in order. So I want to ask you another question. Is your life in order, or do you recognize something you need to change? Well, I recognize two things that I need to change. Some habits I have, and my character, that it's not perfect at all. And I need to change these habits for new habits. And my character, I need to reflect a pure heart. Because we read in Romans 5:8 that blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So in order to see God, we need to have a pure heart. But you know, when I look into the things I said I need to change, the habits and my character, it seems like a mission that is impossible. Because several times I fight against these things, but I fail time after time, and the result is that I got disappointed, frustrated, and discouraged. Well, I assume that you also recognize something in your life that you need to change. And my question is, are you having success changing those things? But how can we overcome failure and achieve success and victory in our spiritual life? If you have the same experience as me, failing after failing, I would like to share with you a war weapon that I discovered years ago, but I forgot to use daily. And recently God showed me again in his word this weapon, and I reveal it right away for you. This weapon is replacement, the weapon of replacement. Actually, the whole Bible, it's like a room packed of war weapons and tactics that we can use against the enemy of our souls. So these weapons and tactics, they are not secret. And you just need to do two things: pray and ask for the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and then you will just need to open the door of this room and you will find a lot of resources. And this is an awesome book, and we will read in 2 Timothy why this is an awesome book. And it says, 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 to 17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. So it's not human writings, it's God's. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction. So it will give us instructions in righteousness. And what's the point of this? That the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. If we want to be perfect, to have a pure heart and intentions, we must read, learn with the life experience we found on this book, and apply the counsels in our life. And I want to invite you to come with me and analyze part of the story of the people of Israel that had problems like me and you. They get away from the Lord, and we will see what God asked from them in order to reconnect their lives with God's heart. Okay, so probably you already heard about the promised land. To cut the story short, the Israelites were in captivity in Egypt, and they were free from that bondage, and they were guided by God through Moses. And they got near to this land, the land of Canaan. And the promised land was a huge territory with several cities, provinces, many nations that were pagan and very powerful, and they lived on that promised land. But God promised to deliver this place to his people. And in Exodus 23, verse 20, we find that, behold, I send an angel before thee. God is saying that he will send his angel before his people to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place which I have separated. Prepared. So, if we look also in the verse 23, the victory was granted over their enemies, because we read, for mine angel shall go before thee and bring thee in unto the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, and I will cut them off. The people of Israel, they had nothing to fear. They had that promise, and along with the promise, a very direct order came also from the Lord. And we will find that order on the verse 24. And it says, thou shalt not bow down to their gods, nor serve them, nor do after their works, but thou shalt utterly overthrow them and quite break down their images. So, a promise and an order. If they accomplish this, the blessings would be sure and vast. And you can read on verse 25 to 28 all the blessings they would receive if they obey this. And you know, on the border of the promised land, Moses sent 12 spies to search the land. And because of the bad report and the spirit of unbelief and rebellion of the majority of the 12 spies, unless two, the people had to go through the desert for 40 years. And after this time, Moses died, and Joshua assumes the leadership of the group, and under God's guidance, the people of Israel starts to conquer Canaan. And one by one, the cities are getting conquered. And they will conquer all the south of Canaan because the Lord God fought for them. And the war against those nations lasts for some years, until Joshua got old and stricken in days. And we find in the book of Joshua, the chapter 13, verse 1, we read, and the Lord said unto him, thou art old and stricken in years, and there remaineth yet very much land to be possessed. So they conquered a lot, but they didn't conquer all the extension of the promised land. So on verse 7, we will read that God has a last assignment to Joshua while leading God's people. And it says, "Now, therefore, divide this land for an inheritance unto the tribes." So, we will see that the whole land, both the parts that already conquered and that which was yet unsubdued, was to be apportioned among the tribes. And it was the duty of each tribe to fully subdue its own inheritance. So they should conquer the rest of the land. And if the people should prove faithful to God, God will drive out their enemies before them, like he promised. And he promised to give them still greater possessions if they would but be true to his covenant. Okay, sorry, the text was here. So, each tribe receives the lands already conquered and the lands that should be subdued. And you know what they did? They rested because they were satisfied with what they already had. They did not make any effort to win the rest of their inheritance. And they started to live and make covenants with the pagan nations. And in Exodus 23, the verse 32 to 33, we read the alert that God made to his people, because he said, "Thou shalt make no covenant with them, nor with their gods. They shall not dwell in thy land. Let them make thee sin against me. For if thou serve their gods, it will surely be a snare unto thee." So, God told them to make no covenant with those strange people and pagan nations. But they got married, they ended worshipping their gods, they lost their physical strength to fight against those nations. Their moral and mental power was weakened. They were far from God and were under the authority of these pagan nations. So, making a parallel between Canaan and my character and my habits and your character and your habits, we will have the following. The conquered lands are the good qualities of my character, of our character, the good habits that I have already developed by the grace of God. On the other side, the land that they had to conquer will represent my character attributes that I need to correct, things that take over me and have a negative effect on me if I let them stay there and live with me. And just like the pagan nations, that the people of Israel did not expel and destroy totally, if I let these things stay in me, they will destroy me. My pride, my impulsiveness, my lack of patience and perseverance, the time I spend watching TV, or the time I spend with social networks, the time I spend listening to music that appeals to our carnal desires, that instead of lifting us up, drags us to dark places. If I'm going to places that I know that God's presence won't be there, friends, what we are doing, it's the same as the Israelites did. We are creating in our homes, high places, altars, not for God, but for the enemy of our souls. And we are worshipping idols and not the God of heaven. And the problem is that we know, because it's written on the Bible, we know what happened to the Israelites when they didn't obey to the Lord. We can read on Patriarchs and Prophets, the following. By their sins, the Israelites were separated from God. His strength was removed from them, and they could no longer prevail against their enemies. Thus, they were brought into subjection to the very nations that through God they might have subdued. So, although they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, yet he did not utterly forsake his people. God had mercy on them. There was ever a remnant who were true to Jehovah. And from time to time, the Lord raised up faithful and valiant men to put down idolatry and to deliver the Israelites from their enemies. But when the deliverer was dead, you know what happened? When the people were released from his authority, they would gradually return to their idols. And thus the story of backsliding and chastisement of confession and deliverance was repeated again and again. So, you see, this was a cycle of apostasy and punishments followed by confession and deliverance. Maybe I'm doing the same about my character and those behaviors that I know I must change before Jesus comes. God can show us in a clear way what we have to change. And we can ask the Lord wisdom and strength. And when we are decided to never do it again, after a while, something happened and we fall again and we make the same mistake. And we got discouraged. We really need wisdom. But if we ask for wisdom, we should ask with faith. Come with me to James chapter 1, verse 5 to 7. And it says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven by the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything from the Lord. So, do you know what happens if a bad habit or a bad character is not destroyed completely? It will turn into some severe and heavy thing in your life that you won't be able to face that problem, and your reaction will be to hide. And this was what happened to the Israelites. Go with me to Judges chapter 6. And on this chapter, you will read about the Amalekites and the Midianites. The Midianites, they were the people of the desert, and this nation had been nearly destroyed by the Israelites in the days of Moses. But see, because they were not completely destroyed, they had since then increased greatly and had become numerous and powerful. So, if you don't destroy something bad, it will grow, and it will get stronger and more powerful. And do you know what the Midianites did to the Israelites? Remember that they had thirst for revenge, right? Because they destroyed their people, their nation. And now they want revenge. And now that the protecting hand of God was withdrawn from Israel, this was the opportunity for them. So, like a devouring plague, the Midianites spread over the country. From the River Jordan to the Philistine plain, they came as soon as the harvest began to ripen, and remained until the last fruit of the earth had been gathered. And they stripped the fields of increased and robbed and maltreated the inhabitants and then return to the desert. Sorry, this is the quote. So, let's go to Judge 6, the verse 2. And here we find that the hand of the Midianite was very heavy on the Israelites. And because of the Midianites, the children of Israel made them the dens which are in the mountains and caves and strongholds. So the people had to run and to hide from the Midianites. They went to the mountains, the caves, because they were very, very bad and they devastated all the land. And this oppression continued for 7 years. And then, as the people in their distress listened to the Lord's reproof and confessed their sin, God again raised up a helper for them. And this time, the helper would be Gideon. So an angel told the mission to Gideon, and he thought, the mission was to fight the Midianites. And he thought, I'm small and I'm unable to do such work. So he wanted to be sure that the mission was coming from God, and God proved him twice that it was a mission coming from him. And God told Gideon to not be afraid because he would not die. And the Lord, And the Lord said unto him, peace be unto thee. In Judges 6, verse 23, fear not, thou shalt not die. And the same applies to us. We will not die if we engage on the mission to renew our mind and characters like Jesus. And after God saying this to Gideon, he will say, and he will reveal the weapon and the war tactic that I already named before. And it says, and it came to pass the same night, and the Lord said unto him, take thy father's young bullock, even the second bullock of 7 years old. And what God is saying to Gideon to do? Throw down the altar of Baal that thy father hath, and cut down the grove that is by it, and build an altar unto the Lord thy God upon the top of this rock, in the ordered place, and take the second bullock, and offer a burnt sacrifice with the wood of the groot which thou shalt cut down. And Gideon will obey, and he took 10 men of his servants, and he did as the Lord had said unto him. You know, just like the father of Gideon had built an altar to Baal where he lived, we many times build altars to our gods, and we spend time worshiping them there. TV, social networks, radio, cinema, shoppings, whatever. We are like Gideon's father. And that's why when we try to fight our bad character, our bad habits, we fail completely. So, what's the key of success? Or at least the key I'm sharing with you tonight? It's replacement. And the same instruction Gideon received is the same we should apply on our battle against our sins, thoughts, and actions. And it says, Gideon was commanded to destroy this altar and to erect an altar to Jehovah over the rock on which the offering had been consumed, and there to present a sacrifice to the Lord. The deliverance of Israel was to be preceded by a Solomon protest against the worship of Baal. Gideon must declare war upon idolatry before going out to battle with the enemies of his people. You know, when we ask God to give up, to help us, to give up of something in our life that is taking his place, when God asks us to conquer a land, we should take that thing off and we should conquer. And remember, and this was something that I learned We should never let that space empty. Never let the land empty. Do you know why? Because the beasts will come to the field that is clean and they will multiply against us. And we find this on Luke. We find another example of this on Luke 11 from the verse 24 to the 26 that says that when the unclean spirit, when someone is possessed or has something bad, and that unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walked through dry places seeking rest. And finding none, he said, I will return unto my house whence I came out. And when he come, he find it swept and garnished. And because this place is not occupied, listen and read with me what he does. Then goes he and take to him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. You know, we must we must be sober and be vigilant, like 1 Peter 5:8 says, because our adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. We need to do our part. We have to pray continuously. We need to ask. We need to search, to knock on the door. Because for everyone that asks, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. Matthew 7:8. God wants us to conquer every sin, every bad character trait, one at a time. Not all at once, one by one, and we will defeat the fault of our character and bad habits by the grace of God and through His Holy Spirit. So, we should identify, we should conquer, and we should dominate. We clear the ground and we replace with something else what was there. And the thing that will replace the old should be something that will build us up, that will bring us closer to God. And in addition to replacement, we must keep on doing that. We should be perseverance. It is not enough to put something there. We must take care and maintain that, which is our new characteristic. And I want to bring in, I brought some examples of practical things that I use to replace some habits that I have, and I'm keeping fighting with them. So these examples, they help me to go closer to God and to listen more about His Word. So, I don't know about you, but I waste a lot of time on social networks. And sometimes we just are doing scroll, you know, and we see others' lives. I like to see, like Bruno said, I like to do crafts, and I enjoy a lot to watch and to do it. But instead of that, I'm trying to replace that actions with other things, like, for example, listen to sermons while I'm doing things at home, or while I'm traveling, driving to the work. And one example of that is you can use the audio verse. They had also an app that you can download to your cell phone. You can do the sermons available offline, so you can listen to that while we are driving without internet. You can watch and learn how the Bible was brought to us through the pioneers and their story through a project on YouTube that is the Lineage Journey. So if you are scrolling on the internet, you can go to YouTube and you can use your time better. And also, if you listen to musics that are not lifting you up or your spirit in God's direction, you can listen to some calm musics and sing with them. If you are used to listen to the radio, and that was one of the problems I had some years ago, and I used to listen radio while I was driving to school, and although I didn't know all the musics from that singers, those popular songs, they come to my mind, and while I was doing something, without noticing, I was singing that song, and I didn't even know that. So if you want something that pops up in your mind without thinking, you can sing along with the Fountain View Academy. Okay, this is one example between others. Maybe in your country you have other examples. Another thing that I use, and in Portuguese we have Portuguese from Brazil, we have some projects, is you can memorize Bible verses singing while you are singing. And this will be a good way to memorize. At least for me and Bruno, it works. And those Bible verses will come to my mind when I need hope, or I'm discouraged. So you can use this app, Scripture Singer, and they had a lot of verses from the Bible. And sometimes they have different versions of songs from to each verse. So let us not waste time, nor let ourselves be carried away by things that satisfy ourselves. What I like, what gives me pleasure. Do not use the excuse that you get from home, you get from work, and you are tired, and you sit on the couch in front of the TV, or using your iPhone or Android, whatever, and your frontal lobe falls asleep, and everything will enter to your mind without filter and without your consent. So the enemy will use this to reach your heart and your thoughts. Remember, and this is the last quote I have to share with you. Remember that the secret of success is the union of divine power with human effort. Don't try to do it by yourself alone. God promised that he will help us. And if you are tired to fight against your lack of time to be with God, do you want to use better your time? To let go the need of always being on Facebook or Instagram or watching movies that promote crime, unfaithfulness, hatred against God. You know, Jesus is coming, and he will come with clouds and great glory, and the multitude of shining angels will attend him, and he will come to honor those who have loved him and kept his commandments, and he will come to take them to himself, like we saw in the beginning, and he has not forgotten them or his promise. In obedience to his moral law, the hearts of the people were to reflect the attributes of his character. You know, our wrong habits should be treated like weeds on our garden. We need to keep them down, and in order to do that, we need to be vigilant. If you, like me, have the desire to put in God's hands all your struggles, all your battles, the addiction you have and that you are trying to get rid of a long time ago, if you need God's help, God's wisdom, I invite you to close your eyes and bow down your head. And if you feel the need, you can bend your knees on the floor. You can do it wherever you are. And I invite you to close your eyes and bow down your head, and I will pray for you. Dear God, Heavenly Father, we thank you because you are a God of victory. You are a faithful God, and you are available to give us wisdom to deal with the enemy. Dear Lord, we have already some cities conquered in our lives, in our characters, but we also have some land to conquer. Please help us to replace those altars to the enemy and help us to build the altar where you can be. Take the throne of our heart. Help us to put in your hands our difficult and our fights, our battles. Lord, I don't know those who are listening to this, but you know their hearts. You know their needs. Lord, we know that the devil is like a lion and he's surrounding us. And sometimes we think that this is impossible to change our character, to let go a habit, an addiction. But oh God, we trust in you and we know that you can give us power through the Holy Spirit and your word to overcome the temptations and the habits and the addictions. Oh Lord, I pray that you will attend each need of us. We know that the enemy works with us in different ways. And something that for me is a problem, it's not a problem for others. But you know the problem and the challenges that we all are facing. Please unite with your power, our effort, and our perseverance. Help us to stay side by side with you and send your angel before us so that the battle will be won by your glory and your hand. We thank you for everything that you will do in our lives, and we ask that you remember us every morning to spend time with you, to open your word, to study these lives, these examples that you left for us. May your Holy Spirit inspire us through this new week. And Lord, we know that with this pandemic, we spend a lot of time at our houses. Please help us to use the time you put in our hands in a better way. Draw us to you and clean our character. And give us a pure heart. So when Jesus comes on those glorious day, we shall see him. And you can take us with him home. We thank you and ask all this, not because we deserve anything, but the sacrifice of Jesus. And in his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much for being with us, and thank you also for the message that reminds us and gives us a new perspective on how we can fight this battle that all of us face daily against the bad traits of character, against the bad old habits. Thank you for joining us, and feel free to join us next Sunday. And also on next Wednesday, we will have our prayer meeting at 9 p.m. CET. Thank you for being with us again, and hope to see you soon.